Yeah, I've been involved in invertebrate pest management and threatened species management from back in my master's day in the early 1990s, where foxes and cats were the main threat to this little dunnart species that I was working on in Western Queensland. And over time, I guess I've been involved consistently with invertebrate pest management and landed myself in the job of the invertebrate pest management officer for Snowy Mountains, Southern Snowy Mountains in the Kosciuszko region of New South Wales with New South Wales Parks, where we first started implementing nil tenure approaches and nil net tenure management plans to basically move the arguments about who owned the pest and who was responsible for controlling the pest away from the planning process to looking at, well, okay, how are these dogs or how are the pests using the landscape? How are they accessing the assets that we're trying to protect? And then what sort of control will be put in place to try and manage it? And through the Invasive Animals CRC back then and then through the Centre for Invasive Species, I ended up in this role as the National Coordinator, basically rolling out that same approach for wild dogs across the country. And as part of that, it's now been, I guess, adopted as the national approach for a number of species, and foxes are no different. So I'm just going to go through a bit of, I guess, management planning and program development 101 around foxes and just highlight some of the key points, I guess, both building on from what Peter said earlier about the importance of planning and approach. I'm not going to go into a great deal of this. I'm unfortunately haven't been part of earlier presentations. But, you know, foxes fairly common now across the countryside. As Pete said, they can increase in numbers relatively quickly. They're very opportunistic and highly adaptive. So, you know, we find them in places where we least expect them to be. And I notice a number of people on the forum are from urban and peri-urban areas where foxes have now distributed themselves right through some of those locations. They do breed once a year, but they do have a lot smaller home ranges in most cases than particularly wild dogs and some other species. So that gives us a few key areas in terms of control that we can target to limit their impact. But as I said, there's also often a lot more than you think. And people often make the fatal mistake of saying, oh, we've only seen a couple and assume that there's only a couple around. But this diagram here on the left was developed from a range of research where they worked on around 2 foxes per square kilometre. And so it doesn't take long to add up to have a fairly significant density of foxes, particularly in highly productive landscapes. And so people who think they're seeing a couple and there's only 3 or 4 around are probably dealing with 10 or 20 or 20 or 40. So as you can see from the photo on the right, this is in the rangelands of South Australia, where foxes are feeding on the remains of the roost shooters clean up at the end of the night. But that sort of density is not only going to have an impact on productivity in terms of agricultural productivity, but also significant impacts on biodiversity. So what is nil tenure? When we're dealing with landholders and, you know, some public land managers, most landholders think about activities and operations on their business, and that's basically what happens inside their boundary fence. And they often think of the landscape as this map that we often used to put up back in the good old days, and we wondered why people threw stones at parks. But obviously the green are national parks and public lands, and all of the white is private land. And so as such, people think about, well, I need to do dog control or fox control or pest management inside my boundary fence. However, we're dealing with highly mobile species that don't obey boundaries. In this case, that white line there is the Shire boundary. It also coincides with a state boundary to the south. And as you can see, there's plenty of landscape, plenty of corridors, plenty of drainage lines for these pests to move backwards and forwards across various tenures to cause impacts on either biodiversity or livestock production. So we need to get people out of that mindset that management of vertebrate pests just has to occur within their boundary fence, and, you know, thinking about how you can apply their control programs or work collectively to manage an issue for the whole region. So this is where the planning process comes into place, and the management plan is an extremely important component of that. But it also, I put in terms of this, control programs need to be planned as well. Ad hoc, poorly thought out control does very little except to maybe get rid of a couple of individuals and potentially scatter the others, or potentially even worse, train the other animals that are there to avoid control in the future. So planning programs is just as important as having a plan about how you're actually going to deliver it. As Peter said, we did go from, you know, large plans back in the day where we had to clearly identify and justify why the programs are being delivered. We had to, back in those days when Peter described about the 14 and 15 page documents, they were developed back then to try and manage the anger and angst and animosity about, you know, where the dogs are coming from and where they were going to. We're in a far better place now, and people have a much better understanding of the necessity to actually undertake control. They also have a better understanding of and relationship, I think, with public and private land managers. So the necessity to have those extensive documents and set the scene, for want of a better term, isn't necessarily there. And if it is there, then we do it anyway. But our plans have come back to quite specific 3 and 4 page documents, maybe not 2 in this case, but I think this one's about 4. This is for a group of cattle producers that I work with in central Queensland. As I said, it's fairly simple. It sets out who the partners are, clearly defines their goals, some of their objectives, what they're trying to manage, provides a justification, I guess, in terms of what is it we're trying to do and why is it important to us. So it sets the scene fairly early on about what they're trying to achieve collectively. It then goes on to describe the control techniques that they're looking to use, the objectives on how they're going to use them, and I guess the actions and who's going to do what where. We have some dates there, but I'll show you the timetable in a minute, which is quite important. Also monitoring impacts, so they're doing that at the moment. So collecting data on livestock impacts as well as sightings, information on control. So they're collecting information all the time, using whatever techniques they can, communication. I see a lot of people here from organisations, and I would love to have given a presentation on the human dimension side of pest management, and maybe that's something we can do later, but try and work out the range of audience. So I've really tailored this to operational delivery. So perhaps, Stu, we can talk about later with some of the human dimensions aspects. But the most important thing in this map, and Peter described the map as being extremely important, but one of the biggest issues that we always have is planning and timetables. In all our plans these days, we have a calendar of control activities and monitoring activities. For years dealing with landholder groups, you know, we find out people didn't participate in a program because they either didn't get notified, or they got notified very late in the piece and didn't have time to be prepared, or they were in the middle of shearing, or they were getting prepared for shearing, or whatever it might be. Having a timetable in place, even if it's just loosely defined like this is with months where they're going to do certain activities, at least provides people with an indication of when they're likely to be called upon to be involved in a program, or when they need to be preparing for it. So I can't highlight enough the necessity to have a calendar, a timetable in the plan. And that's not just for the landholders, but it's also for anyone else who's participating, whether that's public, private land managers, organisations who are there to provide services, whether it's provision of meat or injecting baits, whatever that looks like. But certainly having a calendar in the plan is really important. And then, as Peter discussed, having a map in place to determine where the assets are that are trying to be protected. I didn't put up the one that has all the control and the dog movement corridors. I do have the dog movement corridors. They're the red lines. So once again, as facilitators and people involved in community engagement to deliver these plans, Peter's hit the nail on the head. Sitting a map on the table and gaining information from people actually brings the equality back into the discussion, because I know from being threatened to be shot at at Jindabyne many moons ago, the frustration was purely because a lot of people just felt they were never being listened to. Putting a map on the table and giving people the opportunity to provide their knowledge and history of the area and the situation on a map brings people back to the same level. And that's really important in terms of getting the best out of the people involved in those plans and getting the best out of participation and involvement. So this map here shows in blue areas where they consistently have dog attacks and areas where they consistently find dogs are either residing or traversing to on a regular basis. The red lines just show where those corridors are. And then over time, we've developed other maps to show where they're going to implement their control based on that information. So it all feeds into the development of that control program. Hence, highly important, very important to clearly define, as I said, where the issue is, where the pest is traveling, and then what sort of control you can put in place. And the reality is our control techniques and tools haven't really changed a lot. We're still using baiting. We're doing different types of baiting. We've got different types of substrates to use for baits, manufactured baits and meat baits. We're still shooting. We have modern technology coming into the realm of control now in terms of shooting, but it's still basically the same activity that we've been doing since colonization occurred. We're still using fences. We're using different materials and more, longer lasting material. We're still using traps. We've improved our humaneness of traps. We're using traps now that are used internationally and have welfare considerations taken place. We're still using guardian animals. They've been used for centuries in other places. We use them slightly differently here in Australia. Their effectiveness varies depending on the landscape, the production setting, the fauna you might be trying to protect, and actually the type of animal that we're using. So once again, horses for courses, but a lot of that takes a bit of trial and error. And also the planning process is highly important, because if you do have people using guardian animals, well, then everyone needs to know where they are, particularly if they're dogs or dogs and maremmas that are potentially going to take or get involved in the control of the other species. So that's extremely important as well. And then we've got ejector devices, which I believe were talked about a little bit earlier in the series, that offer a range of additional benefits, like being nailed into the ground, have the 1080 sealed, and have a triggering mechanism that basically only foxes and dogs can really trigger. So it gives you a fair bit more target specificity. So the tools haven't changed. But how do we apply them effectively, I guess, is where I'm coming from with the next few slides. Pete hit the nail on the head, being proactive instead of reactive, and implement control before the impacts are being felt. That's super important in all of the situations. People get anxious, angry, frustrated, trying to manage pests, particularly after they're already seeing the impacts. The importance of that planning approach is to try and determine periods in the ecology where the pest is more sensitive to control. And then also looking where the assets are at most risk. So applying that control proactively before those problems start to occur. Being targeted, and I'll put this in there regularly, something we've really changed, I guess, in the wild dog management space is that more is not necessarily better. Knowing where your predators are or your pest is and placing control in the vicinity of the pest to ensure that it's get exposed to the control technique is really important. Like good old days of just chucking out 1080 baits or doing control programs ad hoc, we've shown through the research we've delivered that you get a much better outcome if you pay a little bit more attention to where the animals are and apply the control in that manner. I've just added a few extra things here about, on average for foxes, 5 to 10 baits per hectare is all you need. You don't need 20, 30, 40, 50. 5 to 10 baits placed in good locations is going to get a much better outcome than putting out more. And once again, you need all forms of control to manage the problem. I get this all the time in the 15 years I've been involved in it. Fixating on one control technique isn't going to solve the problem, and non-lethal control techniques might be just as useful as lethal. So once again, it's about integrating the types of control we're using within a program area and communicating that through your plan. And I just put this here, shooting alone will not manage a predator problem. So, yeah, there's a lot of feel good out of shooting pest animals, and you see that in the media all the time, and there's always calls from various organisations about, you know, hunting and shooters are going to fix it all, but it just doesn't work that way. Certainly is a useful tool, particularly to pick up animals that have avoided other control, but certainly not going to be the be-all and end-all. In terms of cost-effectiveness, baiting is still the cheapest that we've got. It's the most effective, and it does provide 24-hour control, but it comes with some hang-ups, particularly around working dogs, and there's a lot of myths around non-target uptake and negative impacts of 1080. But I also add the non-targets that Peter mentioned. If there are other pests in the landscape, even though they are susceptible to 1080 baits, if they're in the landscape removing baits in large numbers, then it just reduces the effectiveness of the control for the species you're actually targeting. So in many cases, when we do wild dog management programs, we have to undertake some baiting or some control early on to get rid of the foxes first, and then we can have more baits in the landscape and more control specifically targeted to the dogs themselves. So just keep that in mind whenever you're developing a plan or a control program. What other species are there that need to be controlled in addition to or in conjunction with the species that you're concerned with? And I just had some, the dot point there is about, you know, needs to be monitored. Monitor the pest population and monitor any area reductions or monitor the impact of the program itself. In terms of strategies, coordinated baiting programs for population management are the gold standard. If we can get as many people involved in control programs delivered over a regional or at least a local scale, we can reduce populations significantly. Ideally, if we could get as many properties involved as possible over as large an area, we get a better outcome. We have seen up to a 20% increase in lamb survival, particularly in areas where we've done good coordinated baiting twice a year. And ground baiting and targeting those corridors and isolated bushland areas has been highly successful. But unless you've got all of your stakeholders in an area concerned about foxes, it's often very difficult to get people involved. And we often create hurdles or barriers by making fox control and dog control or baiting sound like it's bigger than Ben Hur. And as a consequence, people who have less concern about the issue don't believe they've got the time or inclination to do it. So let's keep it in mind that, you know, small amounts of control, targeted control, having a map, having a plan, all those sorts of things are important to try and convince somebody who doesn't see dogs or foxes or that pest management as a very high priority in their day-to-day life. So keep that in mind. This is probably, I guess, where we've shifted a lot of our approach, in particular areas where we can't get large coordinated baitings happening. Jill hit the nail on the head earlier that you don't always need to have huge numbers of properties to start a program. And if you can even get a couple of neighbours doing it collectively, quite often, if you can demonstrate success at that level, it doesn't take long for other people to get involved. And whether that's to improve lamb survival, whether it's to improve biodiversity, you often need to find out what the trigger is or the hook is to get people involved in the program. And sometimes it's not that they don't want to be involved. It's often that, as Peter said, they don't have the knowledge to do it properly, or they've been misinformed about the control techniques and as such, hesitant to be involved. So getting people to the table and providing that opportunity for them in a non-confrontational manner to explain what those issues are and how they can be involved is a really important role from a facilitator and engagement perspective. So in areas where we've been struggling to get coordinated programs and we've got large densities of foxes in particular, and this was set up, this slide and this presentation that's ever set up for livestock producers. I've been trying to get people to consider a 1 to 2 month replacement baiting strategy leading into lambing. Quite often and historically, you know, landholders think that they can go and get a bucket of baits, throw it out the week before lambing, They'll get rid of the foxes that are there, and everything will be honky-dory. More often than not, however, they might get rid of the foxes they've got, and they draw in all of the foxes from the adjoining properties to come and try and take up the territory that has just been cleared out. And as a consequence of that, they end up with higher predation rates on their properties. So by undertaking a replacement baiting program, once again, small numbers of baits at known locations replaced on a weekly or twice a week basis until they stop going, has proven to be a really successful approach. It means that the baits are actually tied, the known locations, they don't need a lot of them. People know where the baits are, so the risk to the working dogs is reduced. And as I said here, you can use baits like traps or tie and bury or use CPs at known locations and replace them, as I said, as they're taken. That photo on the bottom right-hand corner is a bait station from one of the baits in Kosciuszko National Park in the south. Star picket with a bit of flagging tape. Easy to find, easy to get back to, easy to replace. In terms of bait takes, foxes dig pore over pore and basically just make a little funnel like the photo next to it to remove a bait, whereas dogs generally get in their back legs splayed and just dig it out like a backhoe. So, you know, you can start to collect information on what's actually taking the baits if you can't see the tracks like you can just there. The way dogs and foxes take baits out of the ground are vastly different. So once again, you create more information to determine what to do next. I can't highlight enough the necessity to mark or know where your baits get put out in terms of trying to monitor your program and see where baits are physically being taken from. There's more than enough technology around now to be able to mark and identify where baits go. Tethering baits with wire or even, you know, conduit of some description if you need to, but sand pads and wire is always a good idea to try and work out what's going on. Once again, highlighting those points about putting baits where the foxes are, not in other areas, trying to cover them either with soil if you have to under your state's requirements, or at least putting them under a bit of litter or under bushes makes it easier in terms of avoiding non-target uptake. And also makes it easy to go back and pick them up or cover them before mustering. And look, you know, muzzles, wild dog muzzles, and getting working dogs to wear muzzles is probably still the best insurance to avoid having working dogs take baits. So they're $25 at Elders, the wire muzzles. We've got a video on the Action Plan website about getting dogs used to wearing them. But yeah, I would certainly encourage people to have their stakeholders getting their dogs used to wearing muzzles as soon as they can, basically. I'm not going to go into canine pest ejectors hugely, only to say that they are a game changer in terms of where we can't bait. I think the fact that they can't be shifted provides landholders with a lot more confidence in using poisons on the property. There is a peri-urban wild dog management guide that the centre has just released that has a whole heap of guidelines and methods and processes to use ejectors in some of those peri-urban landscapes. And I think from that perspective, particularly in smaller farms down south, I think it's a real positive step forward for people if they want to get involved. So once again, workshops and building the confidence of people to use them is where increasing that knowledge base might help out. In terms of other times to bait, I'll just put a couple of other things here about asset protection. So, you know, whether it's managing shorebirds or other biodiversity or even just foxes, move out of home and they're easier to pick off in early spring, late spring, early summer. The other thing to notice is that, and this came up at a field day back in WA many moons ago, Khaleesi virus on an annual basis comes through and generally knocks rabbit populations down really quickly. You know, in an evolutionary sense, you know, that food supply disappears really quickly, 2 or 3 weeks, and the population is just about knocked flat. Those areas or those periods where food supply diminishes fast are really good times to target fox control. So if you can you know, wind up your stakeholders or even in your management plans, identify that, you know, Khaleesi virus knockdowns or just after are good times to bait, and people have got manufactured baits on hand. You can get a really good outcome in terms of knocking populations of foxes down in a very short space of time. So I feel like I'm rushing, Julian, but I'll keep going. Monitoring is always important. Creating artificial sand pads if you don't have them, or just getting people used to looking for sign. A large part of what we did through the national plan early on was really increase people's knowledge around what to look for, getting people to stop looking out in the paddock and admiring their grass and looking at the tracks to see what's actually moving up and down the roads. And lo and behold, they often find they have pest animals that they didn't expect. Remote cameras have changed the game plan a fair bit. There's a fair bit of information there about how to use game cameras or remote camera traps to determine activity. That's becoming more and more widespread, and I think many of the people involved in this presentation have used them, and those that are participating. FoxScan, for those people who haven't used it, through the wild dog management space, we're seeing more and more people pick up and use this. It's been set up and developed for people. I'll say the focus groups that we worked on with Peter West were mostly in their mid-60s. And we figured if they could use it, anyone could. But it gives you the capacity to monitor and record activity, sightings, control, using that app. If you don't know much about Wild Dog or Feral Scan, just jump onto the App Store or the Google Play and download it on your phone, and then jump on the web page and have a look. But it gives you the capacity to start to look at where you're doing your control. Once again, feeds the back into your planning process. If you've got numerous people involved, you can soon pick up if you're putting the control where the pest is traveling or where the impacts are being felt. In this instance here, this is a property in Inverell, and you can see that most of the area has been covered pretty well. You've got locations where damage occurred up here, but also they picked up big gaps in their control program where they thought they had good control and baits, but turned out that they had very few, and it was actually in areas where they were doing their lambing. So once again, as part of that review process, you can go back and have a look at your information based on what you've been doing in the past year. As I said, you don't need lots of baits, and you don't need to put out significant amounts of control to get effective management. If you put the baits in areas where you're likely to have that control encountered by the pest. So this is out of our dog baiting guidelines, glove box guides for baiting foxes and dogs, just highlighting for people where the likely locations would be to put some control. You know, everyone's concerned about 1080 particularly and their working dogs. So being able to target specific locations and knowing where they are gives people a bit more confidence. And this sort of a diagram just gives people a bit of understanding about the types of locations to look for. And what I've identified here is, as you can see in the east, those fire trails and management tracks that are right on the edge of bushland, so animals have got plenty of cover to travel back and forth. There's actually a couple of dams tucked into those valleys in both those locations. And then, you know, the uncleared tree lines in the middle of the paddock, you know, likely to where animals are going to reside or get to in terms of get at point A to point B. So, you know, making that very clear to people gives them a better understanding and comprehension of how they can be involved in the programs without, you know, putting their pets or fauna at significant risk. This is just another example that I used from a management planning day. Once again, you know, looking at it aerially at a satellite level, it's pretty easy to see where you'd want to locate baits or put your control, whether they're traps or ejector devices in this landscape, to trying to get effective control of your foxes and improve lambing success. So I think I'm pretty close to the end here, but look, just a bit of a wrap up. Once again, in terms of your baiting programs, 1080 still is the cheapest and it's one of the more effective ways of managing foxes and pest animals. Coordinated programs, in summary, yep, if we can get more people working together over a larger area, we get a better outcome. If we target corridors and isolated areas where breeding occurs or where dogs are moving, we don't need to put out lots of baits and we can limit any risk to non-targets, including domestic dogs. But then, you know, seasonal asset protection, if we time our programs around proactive means of limiting impact on the assets we're trying to protect, that's biodiversity or production. Making sure we tie baits if we're on production property so we can find them and report the number of baits being taken so we can have a clear understanding of what the level of control we need to put out. Highlighting and maintaining that attitude that, you know, more's not necessarily better. Replace baits when they're taken. Leave your working dogs at home. I mean, myself and others probably participating have been involved in programs where we turn up to inject baits and lo and behold, people turn up with dogs on the back of their utes. So it's not rocket science. If you're worried about your dogs, then don't take them out or get them to use muzzles. So just a couple of quick examples. This is a Victorian wild dog program. Took a lot of work, but there's now 17 wild dog management groups or zones in Victoria that undertake coordinated community baiting on private land in conjunction with the control program being delivered on the perimeter of state lands by the department. But what it did do is got a lot of people involved in baiting on their own place, which resulted in a significant knockdown in foxes. And the image in my background here is one of the properties where the landholder there was opposed to 1080 baiting, didn't think it worked, didn't think it would be any good for dog control in particular. Had a trapper that used to come out and do the trapping for him, yet he was still losing a lot of stock. We finally convinced him to do some baiting and he couldn't believe how many dead foxes he found on his place. And as a consequence of that, he then became the land care community baiting coordinator. So, you know, it's just a matter of persistence at times to get people to participate and being involved in these programs and trying to find what it is, what angle, what hook you can get to trigger their interest and get them involved. And often for people, it's the bottom line. So we also have a producer demonstration site over at Mansfield in one of those groups. This is one of the places where this implementing this six-week replacement baiting program on eight properties. In the first year of the project, they're also looking at other causes of death and also other on-farm management to increase lamb survival. But out of 44 lambs that they autopsied, 18% of those are found to have been killed by foxes as the primary form of death. So that's a significant increase in what they expected. Lamb survival, however, on the properties that participated and did the program of the 6 weeks, on average saw a 2-5% increase in lamb survival. So when you look at that across the number of increased lambs that they got out of that process, at $150 a head, it worked out to $42,000 in increased production. And for the cost of box baits, which is around $200 for a bucket of 250, it's a pretty good return on investment. So, you know, these guys are now fairly switched on. Interestingly enough, they're not all adjoining each other. This group is, as I said, eight properties, but they're spread out across the Mansfield area. But they're working collectively, talking amongst themselves about how they're doing stuff. In fact, I think three of the properties are now employing someone to actually do the baits and replace the baits for them over that period. So they've increased a bit of employment for one of the blokes in the district. But all in all, it's been a fairly successful program. So, Jill, I'll leave it there.